start digging into quasi-geostrophic theory and quasi-geostrophic turbulence for this morning, and we'll see how far we get. It seems like lectures aren't getting very far, and I think it's because an hour and a half lecture seems, it's much longer than we're used to typically. It seems kind of infinite, and so you feel, oh, I have plenty of time to. But this morning I have the whole morning, so that is infinite, pretty much. Okay, so what are we trying to do? We'll end up spending a lot of time, hopefully, on a particular dynamical system, a horizontally homogeneous, baroclinically unstable flow in a two-layer quasi-geostrophic model, which I think, my humble opinion, is the simplest model that gives you really interesting insights into how the atmosphere transports heat poleward, which ultimately is what controls the pole equator temperature gradient, the first approximation. Of course, the oceans play a role too. I won't talk about that. I don't know if anyone talked about the partitioning of heat transport between atmosphere and ocean. Did Tapio mention that? It's a remarkable thing. The ocean and the atmosphere are so different, density, mass, whatever, current strength, that they both contribute, roughly significant amounts. They're comparable in their poleward energy transport. Is that a coincidence or not? I don't think so. I don't know if Tapio talked about that, but that's something to think about. I don't think it's a coincidence. But that's not what I'm talking about here. Just talking about atmospheric energy transport, just reminding you that's not the whole story, obviously. But you have to start somewhere. And I'm also just talking about dry dynamics here. And there's quite a bit of transport of latent heat in the atmosphere, as I think we're all aware of. And so dry dynamics is itself only a part of the problem. But it's a pretty interesting part. And we're just talking about quasi-geostrophic theory is designed and is only potentially relevant for the extratropics, outside of the tropics. So it's not a theory that you can use to model the whole spherical climate system. And that's a limitation. But on the other hand, the heat transport through mid-latitudes is the crucial thing that's determining the north-south temperature gradient on the Earth, because that's where your temperature gradient is. And so how much you can fight, the solar radiation is trying to create a big temperature gradient. And that's biggest in mid-latitudes. And so the heat flux in mid-latitudes is the crucial ingredient that is controlling a north-south temperature gradient. The Hadley cell and all this tropical stuff is interesting, but frankly, there isn't much temperature gradient there. So whatever it does, it changes those temperature gradients, but that's not going to change the pole equator temperature gradient that much. It's mid-latitude dynamics that is the zeroth order thing that we have to understand. And we like to understand the north-south temperature gradient. I mean, if your grandmother asks you, what's determining the north-south temperature gradient on the Earth, it'd be nice to have a simple explanation. And unfortunately, this two-layer QG model would be my starting point. As you'll see, we don't even understand that. So your grandmother's going to have to wait a while. We don't understand it, but I mean, what do we understand in all detail? We know something about it. And so this lecture is going to be in kind of two parts. First, I'm going to use the blackboard just to discuss quasi-geostrophic theory, not just the two-layer model, but continuous quasi-geostrophic theory. Because first of all, I think it's important to have a feel for the form, the mathematical structure of the theory in general. I know the audience is diverse, so just want to bring people up to some level. But obviously, I don't have time to derive things very much. I'll just sort of display things. But I also want to introduce continuous quasi-geostrophic theory for a reason to contrast it with the two-layer model in some respects. It's pretty interesting, and I think it's more interesting than a lot of people realize, that the two-layer, if you're looking at, say, linear instability theory, of sort of classic problems like Charney and ED, and try to mimic that in a two-layer model, it's a terrible approximation. For at least when you have the Bethe effect present. And we'll mention that briefly. In a a two-layer model, there's a critical vertical shear, critical horizontal temperature gradient required for baroclinic instability. In Charney and Eby model, there's no critical shear required for instability. That's a pretty dramatic difference. In fact, the growth rate in both Charney and Eby models basically just is proportional to the temperature gradient. It couldn't be more different in that. So how can you use the two-layer model to talk about the general circulation of the atmosphere? If it doesn't, it's not a good approximation to continuous quasi-geotrophic theory for linear theory. But I'd like to argue, and I don't think this is discussed much at all in the literature. I've never really tried to be explicit about it, I don't think. But I think the two-layer model is a better model of the general circulation of the atmosphere than is a continuous quasi-geotrophic model. That if you don't truncate in the vertical, your answer gets worse. For a general circulation that looks like the Earth, that's as energetic and as, and that's a subtle point. So in some sense, there's continuous QG theory, and I'm not gonna, may not be able to convince you of this, and maybe it's not that important. But continuous QG theory is better for small disturbances, linear theory, but QG theory effectively breaks down in important ways when you try to apply it to a system as energetic as the Earth's atmosphere. And what do we really mean by energetic? One way, I'm not going to present QG theory in this way because in any detail, but this is the picture we have in our mind. We often, in thinking about QG theory in the atmosphere, we think about isentropic layers, or if you're thinking about the ocean, you have isopictal layers. So it's just a way of discretizing your system in the vertical to think about. Instead of having continuous things, you discretize, and in the atmosphere we talk about potential temperature rather than density, or entropy if you like, the same thing. The entropy of the ideal gas. So you have layers, in the atmosphere of different potential temperature, and it's stably stratified. Potential temperature here is bigger than the potential temperature here. And you have a surface. And one of the complications when thinking about quasi-geostrophic theory, in a sense, the theory is telling you to think in isentropic coordinates, think in terms of layers. That's what the mathematics is sort of telling you. We're going to try to avoid that, but but then you have to deal with these layers intersecting the surface. And the two-layer model, because it's so crude, and you're just saying, oh, I'm just going to consider one interface, at least in mid-latitudes, I can avoid talking about the interface intersecting the surface, which is convenient, but also important, because if you have a bunch of layers that are intersecting the surface, you get, how shall I say this? It's a measure of how energetic the atmosphere is. You say, what set of isentropic layers intersect the surface? Here in the latitudes, and in the time mean, maybe these layers aren't intersecting the surface, but I have a lot of eddies. And so these layers are going up and down Tapio 9, a paper a while ago, referred to this as the interrupted layers of the atmosphere, these uninterrupted layers. And the one way you can think of the dynamics of the uninterrupted layers and the interrupted layers tend to be very different. And in quasi-geostrophic theory, not always made explicit, you're assuming that these this region of interrupted layers is thin. In fact, it's infinitesimally thin in the standard quasi-geostrophic theory. You're assuming that there's no isentropic depth to this interrupted layer. So everything is sort of nice, and sure, there's isentropes intersecting the surface, but they only meander away from the surface an infinitesimal amount. It seems like that's not what the Earth looks like. It's not that. That's fine for linear theory, but it's not very good for the general circulation. This is maybe kind of mysterious, but yeah, I'll try to come back to it. And that's one of the things I And I'm a little confused about that myself. So why not try to lecture about things that one is confused about? Let's go back to two-layer. So one of the amazing things about quasi-geostrophic theory is the analogy with two-dimensional flow. In fact, for some simple problems, some linear problems, there's an isomorphism between pure baroclinic instability and pure barotropic instability, which is surprising because the source of energy, as I think most of us know, for baroclinic instability, which is to say the source of energy of all of our weather in mid-latitudes, is the potential energy, or as we call it, the available potential energy. If you start out with flat density surfaces, say, in a Usinesque model, or flat isentropes in an ideal gas, and then you disturb it. Let's think of density for simplicity. So here we have high density, and here we have lower density. And you disturb it, you're moving high density up, lower density down. You're raising the center of mass of the fluid. So that system has available potential energy. If you can tap that available potential energy and go back to this more horizontal configuration, you can release that. That's where our energy comes from for our mid-latitude weather. It's releasing that available potential energy. But what does that have to do with two-dimensional flow, where all you have is kinetic energy? And they seem very different things. Something very, maybe deep or just mysterious in the mathematics of mathematical structure of QG theory, that there's a remarkable analogy. When I say mathematical structure, I'm not saying anything esoteric. I'm just talking about what the equations look like. I'm not really a mathematician. So 2D flow, people have talked about a lot. I use this notation of Jacobian. Other people use this notation? It's advection of this tracer vorticity. Let's put in the Beatty effect right away. Beautiful thing is everything's defined in terms of a stream function. So it's one equation, one partial differential equation, one unknown. Which 2D flow is not too surprising because you're assuming the divergence is zero. You have divergence vorticity. There's no divergence, so why shouldn't the vorticity describe the flow totally? And it has this structure that, again, we're all familiar with, of useful to think of integrating this equation in time as a two-step process. First you have a flow, you have initial condition, you advect the vorticity. And then second step is you look at what flow is induced by that vorticity distribution, which means just solving the Poisson equation. This Poisson equation, I guess you need some boundary. Let's forget about boundaries for the moment. So there's this interesting two-step process, advect and then see what you've induced by that advection. And there's this Beatty effect. The Beatty effect is a beautiful thing. You probably talked about that quite a bit too, I'm sure. It's quite remarkable in its role in geophysical fluid dynamics. There aren't very many systems there are other systems in which you have a background, a monotonic vorticity gradient of one sign. But a rotating sphere gives you that automatically because we're interested in the radial component of the vorticity. The vorticity of solid body rotation is just twice the angular velocity of the, that has no spatial structure, but the radial component varies monotonically from pole to pole. So you have a rotating sphere gives you a monotonic vorticity gradient automatically, on which everything else is superimposed. And having that changes everything. And if you just take some shear flow in the laboratory, your vorticity gradients are going to be all over the place because you don't have any, typically, a natural large-scale vorticity gradient that you're working in, typically. Okay, and I say I'm interested in climate, so if I want to make a climate, I have a 2D model. Of course, I'd have to have forcing and dissipation. And we've seen examples like yesterday in Freddie's talk of forcing being stochastic stirring. And the dissipation, had two parts, which is very typical. So if you have some kind of damping, let's say just typical case is just linear damping, so you have the vorticity. You have to get rid of the energy in the flow on large scales somehow. And then you have some very scale selective, you know, let's say delta the n here. So just symbolically, something that's very scale selective, that's mopping up the entropy on small scales, because you're going to affect this tracer down to small scales, this vorticity. So entropy is going to pile up. If you don't do something with it, it's going to be problematic, in a numerical model at least. So it's a mopping up operation. You hope the parameter here, whatever it is, doesn't matter. If I have time, I don't know how much I'll have time. I'd like to come back to that question. Is that okay? Are we really independent of that parameter? But let me make one point here. We might say, especially if you're new to this, I don't know, depends on your background. I say, well, what the system I'm really interested in when I'm talking about two-dimensional flow is, Navier-Stokes friction. So I'm really interested in Laplacian, just standard Laplacian viscosity. And anything I'm doing with my numerical model at finite resolution, because my Reynolds numbers aren't high enough, I'm just really trying to approximate the solutions of this equation. That's not the way I think about the problem at all. I'm not interested in Navier-Stokes friction in this two-dimensional problem. Because this two-dimensional, from the point of view of meteorology and oceanography, I think almost invariably, probably some counterexample somewhere, but almost invariably, this is just an effective theory, if you like. It's only valid on certain scales. We're never two-dimensional down to the Kolmogorov microscale where the flow is laminar. A lot of things happen between scales in which we're two-dimensional and the Kolmogorov microscale. A lot of three-dimensional things happen. So I can't think of an example where I'm interested in Navier-Stokes friction. So to my mind, Navier-Stokes friction has no special standing here as a mopping up operation for the entropy. It's not more interesting than some other way of mopping. And there may be much more interesting, physically, better ways of mopping up the entropy than Navier-Stokes friction. Just wanted to make that point. No one objects. There's a whole other question about if you actually had a two-dimensional gas, what equations would that satisfy? That's a completely different question. Would Navier-Stokes be the correct macroscopic theory for a real two-dimensional, where molecules are just moving in 2D? That's yet a completely different question. That's not what we're interested in meteorology and oceanography anyway. All right, so what kind of forcing might we, let's just look at this equation for a minute. If we forget about forcing and dissipation, we conserve energy. We can multiply this equation by the stream function. And you manipulate it usual ways. You integrate by parts, you throw away boundary terms, which is just saying you want to assume there are no energy fluxes out of the boundaries of your system, however you've defined your system. Assuming that's the case, then you find that you're conserving, integrated over the domain, the kinetic energy. And of course, UV is a non-divergent flow defined in terms of the stream function. This problem just conserves kinetic energy. Okay. And we're almost always, at least in lectures this morning, we'll be interested in geometry that's re-entrant in the x direction. But after all, we're interested in the sphere ultimately, and everything in spheres re-entrant in longitude. We may worry about the boundary conditions in latitude, as I failed to mention that I'm not considering, I mean, you can consider, of course, two-dimensional flow on the sphere, but I want to go to the beta plane right away, because in QG theory, you have to confine yourself to mid-latitude. So why not confine yourself to a beta plane, which means Cartesian geometry. And the only remnant of the spherical geometry is this background planetary vorticity gradient, which we're just assuming is a constant, beta. It doesn't have any spatial structure. Okay, so let's not worry about the north-south boundaries. And then some problems, you may want to consider an explicit channel where you have walls to confine things, your beta plane in the north-south. That's dangerous. There are no walls in the atmosphere. That's a good proverb, I think. No fences. Right? No politics. And so if you're doing a problem in a beta plane channel and you're worrying about what's happening at the walls, you're doing something wrong. Because you're worrying about the wrong things. There are no walls in the atmosphere. You don't want to start worrying about some peculiar behavior happening at the walls of your channel. Maybe in oceanography or something, but not in meteorology. That's just a warning. If you're putting yourself in a mid-latitude channel, make sure there's nothing happening at the wall. So anyway, if we have zonal re-entrant, we almost always are interested in one level or another in zonal averages. And for this barotropic model, we're interested in the zonally average momentum, especially. There's no zonally average mean meridional circulation because we're non-divergent. Yep. I'm getting worried. I haven't got the QG theory yet.
Doesn't work? Okay. A question about the walls. So in the atmosphere, there are pretty high mountains. So can it be a kind of wall?
If you're here in Les Zouches, maybe you'd have some dynamics where you could approximate with the wall. That's not the typical situation. It's beautiful, but it's not typical. Okay, so we derive an equation for the zonally average zonal flow. And so I'll use the notation of prime as a deviation from the zonal flow, but no, not saying anything about linearity or nonlinearity or anything. And I think we all know that in this model, in the absence of the forcing and dissipation, this zonal mean zonal flow here would just evolve by convergence or divergence of momentum flux. That's it. That's easy to derive. And there's an interesting little identity, which I think you can all prove, and maybe you've proved it many times already. The eddy vorticity flux, nothing to do with linearity again, it's just a consequence of the nigh divergence of the flow, is the convergence of the eddy momentum flux. Those are the same thing. Simple proof. So I can also write this as a vorticity flux. You can get this directly from Kelvin circulation theorem if you want. The vorticity flux is what we need to know to understand how the flow evolves in general. You shouldn't have to think about, well, I say the vorticity in this model is everything. So clearly, in some sense, the vorticity flux is what we're interested in. Because why should I think about momentum flux? It's vorticity that defining the state of the system. I can if I want to talk about momentum, but I don't have to. I can just talk about vorticity fluxes, and that's nice because vorticity is conserved. Maybe because it's conserved, it's easier to think about what the flux is doing than a momentum flux, where if you look at momentum equation, before you zonal average, the momentum equation has pressure gradients in it. Momentum isn't conserved following a fluid particle. Vorticity is. So maybe just at least at an intuitive level, it's easier to think in terms of vorticity fluxes driving. What else can I say? Let's talk a little for a moment about still on 2D. Everything I'm saying here has an exact analog in quasi-geostrophic theory. That's why I'm mentioning it. Let me linearize about some zonal flow, U of Y. That zonal flow will have a mean vorticity gradient. Will be, if there's a beta effect, it'll be beta minus the curvature. You can call that gamma of Y. The vorticity is du dy. The vorticity gradient is the curvature. And then the beta is the environmental vorticity gradient. If I linearize about some zonal flow, linearize this vorticity equation without forcing. Now, here the prime implies linearity as well. You know, the dynamics is just advection of the vorticity perturbation by the flow and the meridional advection by the perturbation of the environmental vorticity gradient. That's all you have and when you linearize it. So I can manipulate this equation. One very important manipulation is what many of us call the pseudo-momentum conservation law. Let me just assume gamma is positive everywhere. So the vorticity gradient, it's like beta is dominant, just to keep things. So I want to divide by gamma. And then I'll divide by gamma and then multiply by the vorticity and average over x, and you get the famous equation. This minus gamma, or divided by gamma, v prime zeta prime. The rate of change of zonal momentum is given by the rate of change of this quantity, the pseudo-momentum of the eddy field. I can go back and forth in linear theory. This is the quantity I need to know how it's changing if I want to know how the eddies are modifying the mean flow. It's an interesting quantity. It's not energy. It's not entropy. It's pseudo-momentum. It's a conservation law in the sense that if I integrate over latitude now, I've already, the bar, I don't know if I made that clear, is a zonal average. And now I'm just working in linear theory, but if I average over latitude, the vorticity flux is the momentum flux convergence. That integrates to zero, as long as I'm not exporting momentum out of my domain, conserving momentum. This is a conservation law. Linear disturbances maintain their pseudo-momentum. By the way, this vorticity flux is, and you might think, oh, vorticity is conserved, might be advected in rather intuitive ways, like a passive tracer in some complicated turbulent flow. You have to be careful. The vorticity flux is the divergence of another flux, divergence of momentum flux. It's another way to say you have to, whatever's going on is going to have to conserve momentum. You can't just mix vorticity arbitrarily and conserve momentum. Momentum flux is the divergence of the momentum flux. Okay, so this is a conserved quantity. This gives you the Rayleigh-Kuo criterion for instability. Because if gamma is of one sign, that Rayleigh originally, you know, I don't think he had beta at all, but Kuo in 1950 or so added the beta effect. And sometimes it's called the Rayleigh-Kuo criterion, in meteorology anyway, that you're stable if gamma is of one sign, and interesting cases if it's positive. And why is that? Well, this is just a positive definite quadratic norm, which is conserved, which means that if you start with infinitesimal disturbance, it always has to stay infinitesimal. Nothing to do with normal modes or anything, it's just generically. Some people would call that stability in the sense of Lyapunov or whatever. Yeah, so this is a norm for the eddy. It might look unfamiliar, but it's just the entropy divided by some positive function of y. If you start out infinitesimal, that quantity is infinitesimal. So it'll always be infinitesimal. So nowhere in your domain can the eddy become finite amplitude, because you couldn't maintain infinitesimal norm. So that's a very general way of, you don't have to manipulate any, you don't have to assume normal mode form, and things like that. This normal mode form of the, I think Jeff still has it in his book. I don't know if, yeah, both, okay, good. I wish that normal mode form would just die. People would forget it. It's much easier just to talk about it. This is much more general statement of what's possible. Okay, that's a famous result. That sort of indicates why it's so important to, why beta is playing. It's very stabilizing because it's a background vorticity gradient of one sign. All right, what else should I say about that? I made a list of things to talk about. So I'm forgetting. Just one more thing. So I made the statement in my first lecture, and I didn't really, at least my own work, and I'm not dogmatic about this, obviously, I'd rather avoid stirring the system, because the stirring adds more parameters. I'd like the system to be self-stirred and deterministic. Why should I make something stochastic that's really deterministic? That's my only reason I make something stochastic is I want a simpler model to mimic my deterministic system. From my classical perspective, the world is deterministic. But you know, I may do that to sort of simplify the system, make some approximate some things with stochastic noise, but I want to avoid that if I can, because that introduces potential parameters. So what kind of system might I talk about in this two-dimensional problem? Well, you could relax, the forcing could be relaxation to some, say, the momentum equation. This is really, it could be say, a relaxation, and I'll incorporate this damping into the forcing. A relaxation to some imposed velocity, or in a vorticity sense, it's just damping to some, let's say it's zonal mean. It's only symmetric, some vorticity distribution. So if there are no eddies, I just relax to this equilibrium. How about that? Let's suppose that's unstable, and then you develop eddies. But we're making the problem horizontally inhomogeneous when we do that. I don't think there's any way in this barotropic problem to create a homogeneous turbulence problem without stirring or something like that. If I try to create instability, I'm creating inhomogeneity, horizontal inhomogeneity. The baroclinic problem is fascinating in that I can create a horizontally homogeneous problem that's self-stirred. I don't have to create a horizontal inhomogeneity. That's an essential point. Let's just think about one example here, which I think is an interesting one. Again, because of analogy with QG theory, here's a zonal flow that I'll relax to. It's called a point jet, a point easterly jet. The flow here is, if I think of this as the zero, this is easterly, if you like. This is barotropically unstable. Why? Because there's a lot of curvature here. Obviously, there's an infinite amount of curvature here. You can think of smoothing that out a little bit. And so there's a lot of d squared u dy squared is very big here. It's a delta function in the limit. And so that's going to over, you're on a beta plane. This is going to overwhelm beta close to that center of that jet. And so that's unstable by the really cool criteria. And it is formally unstable. By the way, because time is flying as usual, doing the linear, if you haven't done it, and most people haven't, I don't know if Jeff has it in his book, even. But it is in his book, even though he might not realize it, because this instability problem is isomorphic to the Charney instability problem, in the Boussinesq version of Charney instability problem. So people look at the Charney instability problem, you have all these hypergeometric functions floating around, and say, oh, I'm never going to understand quasi-geostrophic baroclinic instability, that's too complicated a subject. That derivation doesn't give me any intuition for what's going on. That complication has nothing to do with quasi-geostrophic theory. The instability problem is turns out to be isomorphic to this barotropic problem, a point jet. There's something interesting beyond that. Okay, so it's unstable. So let me let this go nonlinearly. So this is my forcing and dissipation all rolled into one. And then I have some usual mopping up term, and just let it go. People have done this. What happens? Well, what do you think of it? There's this intuition on many problems like this that is not always right, but it's not a bad place to start quite often, is that at finite amplitude, the instability is trying to stabilize the flow. Why not? You know, that's kind of an anthropomorphic statement about what instabilities are trying to do, but it's how would you go about stabilizing this flow? You have to get rid of this very, and you want to do it There's no reason to mess around with the new flow way out here. This is the source of the instability, right? This corner. How would you stabilize the flow in sort of the minimal, with a minimal amount of work? I'm not making work precise here. But, well, you have to get rid of this sharp curvature, and you have to bring the curvature down to beta, right? If you're going to stabilize it by the Rayleigh-Kubok criterion. And so you have to do something like this. So this curvature is now equal to beta. And so you have to modify the flow up to a certain, at least for a certain scale here, if you have any hope for creating a stable climate, if the climate is going to be a flow that's linearly stable. Not proving anything here. So what is this scale? Well, you can, if this shear, this dy here is lambda. So I guess u itself is just lambda, absolute value of y. That's u sub e. That's the flow I'm relaxing to, the unstable flow. There's just one parameter there, lambda, which is the shear. So the scale of over which I have to modify the mean flow is what? It's lambda over beta. That's the only way I can get a length scale. Right, beta has units of 1 over length time because it's the gradient of a vorticity. Vorticity is 1 over time. And lambda is just units of 1 over time. It gives me a length. I think that's right. So that's, you do this problem numerically, that's what you'll find. You'll find the eddies pretty much are confined to that region. I mean, there's always room for subtleties. So this problem is, I know you worry about, people who worry about ergodicity and stuff like that worry about, is, you know, what's preventing the eddies from spreading over this whole domain? They just, well, there's no reason for them to, for one thing. And they're, you can say more than that. They're constrained from modifying the mean flow significantly. So that's interesting how this scale emerges. I'm going to come back to this in the Bear Clinic case very briefly. I think that's it for 2D. Any questions? Good. We'll go to QG theory now. Things get a little more confusing, frankly. So what is a good, there's many different starting points. I'm going to use
Isaac, before you go to 2D, is there a classical reference about
this point jet?
This pointer, yeah.
There's a classical, I don't
I mean
know.
A reference.
Just Google barotropic point jet. There, I'm guessing there are half a dozen. The first I encountered was a paper by Dick Lindzen, actually, but I'm not necessarily recommending that paper. Actually, what's this? He was here. This is the guy who's at Brown, applied mathematician. Marson, he has a paper. Trying to do some you know, fancy closures, cumulative expansions and things. Because you might, you know, this is an interesting little problem. You know, this is just the mean flow model. By the way, this can't actually happen the way I drew it. I end up spending too much time on these things. But the way I formulated this problem, the time averaged momentum integrated over latitude has to be equal to the time averaged momentum integrated over latitude of this equilibrium profile because the dynamics is just redistributing momentum. So this can't happen. Because here I'm just moving them. So what actually happens is a little broader than that because you have to conserve momentum. Anyway. You know, I don't think there's a I don't think there's a classic reference. There's no place where people have really pounded this problem to death and say, okay, this is really very high resolution simulation. This is the eddy spectrum, eddy kinetic energy spectrum that I get and all that stuff. But maybe there is, and I don't know about it. Okay, QG theory. If there are no other questions. Easiest place to start, and this is continuous QG theory. I'm going to work in a Boussinesq atmosphere or fluid. I could work with an ideal gas. And as you go to the QG limit, it doesn't make any difference at all, except in some little details which are, you could say, not fundamental in the lower boundary condition. And not even worth thinking about in this context. So we're not losing anything by talking about a Vucinesca atmosphere. At the level we're talking about things here. But it may be a little confusing because in Vucinesca atmosphere you're talking about density and stably stratific. Yep. What is Vucinesca? Yep. Okay. Yep.
Mm-hmm. How do we get these barotropic equations, say from the 2D 2D equations?
What barotropic equations?
Those two.
These two?
Yeah.
Oh, it's an exercise. It's just take the zonal average of the equation. You may have to integrate it in Y to go from vorticity to momentum. That's it. Kind of important. If you write down the 2D equations in terms of the momentum equation, it only very simple. You have pressure in your experience also. But in terms of vorticity, they look extremely simple. But sometimes when you want to talk about the mean flow, you want to go back to the. This is. Okay. I don't have time to go through derivations here. So what is the quasi-geostrophic vorticity equation that replaces the two-dimensional vorticity equation? We're still, what's the thing? I interrupted my thought, I'm sorry. We're working with the Boussinesq system. So we talked about density gradients, and this, the stratification of the atmosphere is measured by the buoyancy frequency. This is G. Boussinesq system, we just think of the density as being a small departures away from a mean density. You can think of these as being the small departures, if you will. But then when you think about the atmosphere, and sometimes you have to go back and forth in your own mind, we're not thinking about density of the atmosphere. We're talking about, you have to replace density with potential temperature, because the quantity that in the ideal gas that's controlling the stability is the same formula, but in terms of potential temperature. That's just a source of confusion, but hopefully it won't confuse things too much. Because to actually work with the ideal gas, it's a detail, but it just things look a little more complicated sometimes, but they're really not. So I'm going to stick to density. But we're not talking about the density of the atmosphere. Anyway, before talking about that, let's talk about the vorticity equation. So I think we're all aware QG theory fundamentally assumes the Rossby number is small. And what that means is that the Coriolis force and the pressure gradient are the dominant terms in the equation of motion. The lowest order of the flow is geostrophic. Again, I don't want to spend too much time on it, but we're also assuming the flow is hydrostatic right from the start. That effectively means we're working with a thin layer of fluid, and we're talking about horizontal scales much larger than the depth of the fluid, or the scale height of the atmosphere. And so we're hydrostatic and geostrophic, and from those two things, we derive the thermal wind equation. It's this beautiful relationship that, for example, FdU dz, well, let me use the buoyancy expression. Do I have the sign right here? For example, so I'm going to use the buoyancy as minus g, say rho 1 over rho 9. It's the density in units of acceleration. And again, it's I want to use temperature instead of density if I'm talking about an ideal gas. So it's relating the vertical shear of the geostrophic wind to the horizontal gradient of the density field or the temperature field and for an ideal gas. I think we've all seen thermal wind. It's fundamental to just picturing what's going on in the atmosphere. We have jets in the upper troposphere of the Earth because we have a north-south temperature gradient. And the answer is in thermal wind balance. There's no mystery about it. People talk about, how do I maintain the upper tropospheric jet? I literally can curl. Yeah, there's nothing to maintain. You can talk about, well, I can say, how do I maintain the horizontal temperature gradient? It's the same question. It's just a funny, sometimes people ask funny questions. Whenever I hear the word maintain, I worry about what are they talking about. Okay, so we have this beautiful relationship, and for V. And also, this sort of distinguishes quasi-geostrophic theory from what people sometimes call planetary geostrophic dynamics. In the geostrophic relationship, we're going to replace the Coriolis force by a constant value of the Coriolis force, which is really assuming there's another small parameter in the problem, that the beta effect is only producing small departures of F from it. So you're confined to some kind of mid-latitude channel. F isn't changing very much. And that makes the geostrophic flow, if you think about it for a moment, exactly non-divergent, whereas otherwise it wouldn't be. Otherwise you would get what people call Sverdrup balance. Where the geostrophic flow has a divergence that can be important in some context, but in QG theory you're ignoring that. And we've already said that U and V are they're going to be ascribed in terms of a stream function. They have a non-divergent flow. It's in the same way as before. But now we also have buoyancy. Is just F naught deep psi VZ. You can check that if you like. So now the stream function is not, this is thermal wind equations, it's an incredibly powerful constraint. Geostrophic stream function for this non-divergent geostrophic flow is determining not just the flow, it's determining the temperature field as well, but it's vertical derivative. A little F naught in there, but. That's a key to QG theory. Okay, vorticity equation. I'm gonna assume the flow to the lowest order is non-divergent, so the vorticity is still the Laplacian of the stream function, of the geostrophic flow. This is, we're talking about three-dimensional space here. We haven't made any assumption about two-dimensionality. But this is the vertical, we're just looking at the vertical component of the vorticity. Because we're assuming the only, again, not going through a formal scale analysis, the most important term you have to retain to talk about mid-latitude dynamics that's missing in the two-dimensional flow is the stretching of vorticity by vertical motion. And another key point is the Rossby number is small, so what is the vorticity of the flow to lowest order? It's just a planetary vorticity. You don't have to think about the stretching of the relative vorticity. So the stretching is just, you're just taking the planetary vorticity and you're stretching it by some vertical motion field. That's the vorticity equation in quasi-geostrophic theory. You can go through some rigmarole and show that's the dominant term. So advecting the vorticity, just as in 2D, with your non-divergent flow, but there's a stretching. That's important. Otherwise, you don't get anything. Obviously, you're back to 2D. You don't have that stretching. Okay, but we need another equation now, and then we have a buoyancy equation, or a thermodynamic equation, right? Or a temperature equation. This buoyancy is just a stream function, really just vertical derivative of the stream function. Right? See, the vorticity is the horizontal Laplacian of the stream function. The buoyancy is the vertical derivative of the stream function. We're going to invect that with the geostrophic flow. But what's we need something else. And something else is we have vertical advection of buoyancy, W dB dz. But just as here, we're going to make this another assumption, and this is critical, that the static stability of the atmosphere is not changed very much by the flow field. There's a basic static stability, which now I'll call n squared of z. I guess I can call it n0 squared, but I'm going to drop the zero. And that can be z-dependent. And for many applications, that z-dependence is very important. The static stability of the base, there's a basic state static stability that the theory is not going to try to explain. That's the one. This theory as constructed is fundamental to quasi-geostrophic theory. You cannot explain the basic stratification of the atmosphere. If you want to try, and that's one of the things we're really like to understand, obviously. What determines that, how stable the atmosphere is gravitationally. QG theory can't help us, that's disturbing. But I don't know if I have time for it, but Lorentz sort of inspired, he had a couple of papers where he just QG theory and then sort of outside of the, use the results from QG theory, and outside of the QG theory, you think about how the static stability is maintained. So you use the fluxes, eddy fluxes that come out of QG theory. But it's kind of sloppy in that it's not self-consistent. So it's one of the reasons to go to more complete dynamical systems is to be able to talk about the static stability of the atmosphere, what's determining it. But we just have to accept it here. We're just perturbing, if you like, about some reference state, which is stably stratified. And of course, the dynamics changes the buoyancy field, so the local buoyancy frequency will be, you know, spatially dependent and everything, but you have to assume it's a small departure from this reference. And so for the vertical advection, you can just assume. You can just assume your vertical velocity is just affecting the basic state stratification. And that's your QG vorticity and buoyancy equations. So there's ageostrophic motion. Think of it as a perturbation theory, the lowest order geostrophic to first order. Now the geostrophic motion evolves due to the lowest order approximation to the ageostrophic motion. This vertical motion is completely ageostrophic. But you can see from the structure of these equations, this is ddt of the Laplacian. This is ddt of f naught d psi dz. These two are have to be self-consistent. And so this constraint that the vorticity and the buoyancy evolve to maintain geostrophic balance, to maintain thermal wind balance, determines the ageostrophic velocity. You don't need an equation for the ageostrophic velocity. It's slaved to the geostrophic motion. And given that it's slaved to the motion, you want to formulate the equations in such a way that you don't even refer to the geostrophic. Why do you refer to it at all? And that's easy to do. And so on one hand, you could manipulate this equation to get an equation for the vertical motion. You end up with an elliptic equation for W. If you know how all these other terms, you can solve for W. But alternative, which is way much nicer, is to eliminate W from these equations. Which means just you know, divide by n squared and take the vertical derivative of this equation. Add or subtract if I have the signs right here to eliminate W. And then what the equation you get, let me just, I'll leave this as a little exercise too. I can eliminate W, I end up with what's called the quasi-geostrophic potential vorticity equation. Or Charney, after about 10 or 20 years of thinking hard about the subject, started calling it the quasi-geostrophic pseudo-potential vorticity equation, for a reason which I won't even go into. It's not always the case that a little q is an approximation to the Urteil potential vorticity, which is why he changes terminology. One of those little details, but let's not even worry about Urteil potential vorticity. What is q? I left off beta y here, but you can always bring up the beta effect into the problem again. So we have the horizontal Laplacian. This is in the interior of the flow. How about at the surface? In the atmosphere, we have a surface. Surface is pretty important, a lot of things. And what's the boundary condition at the surface? Oops, too many equal signs. F0 squared, yes. Thank you. And to derive this, you have to, it's not totally, I mean, it's just very simple derivation, but you have to, for example, use the fact that ddz of the Jacobian of psi d psi dz is the Jacobian of psi d squared psi dz squared. The other term you get is the Jacobian of d psi dz times d psi dz, which is zero. Because, but anyway, you can derive this equation. And the boundary condition at the surface you get from the thermodynamic equation. W is zero. So what's the boundary condition? It's just dB dt. I can say dd psi b, where b is d psi dz. That's just at z equals zero, assuming the surface is flat. That's QG theory. Without any forcing or dissipation, adiabatic and viscid quasi-geostrophic theory. Think about the structure, first of all, of this equation. It takes some getting used to. It's now, we have this single tracer, Q. We don't have any U's, V's, pressures, or anything. We just have this Q. It's advected by the flow of psi. At each level in the atmosphere, we have a different psi, which is advecting Q at each level. And so think about how you'd integrate this equation forward in time. You have the flow and potential vorticity and the surface buoyancy at some instant in time. You advect the potential vorticity in the interior with that flow for some little time interval. You advect the surface buoyancy for that same amount of time. Then you have to figure out what the flow is that's consistent with a new potential vorticity field and surface buoyancy field. And that just means you have to invert this three-dimensional elliptic operator. With the boundary condition, with the Neumann boundary condition, because you're specifying d psi dz at the surface. It's a standard boundary condition for it's just Poisson's equation. And that the boundary condition is determined by the surface buoyancy evolving. Yeah, so that's the way you march forward in time in this. So typically you have to think about the surface buoyancy as part of the potential vorticity field, if you like. It's entering the problem the same way. And so how is our different levels in the atmosphere communicating with each other? This is the key, that this potential vorticity is not being advected in the vertical. There's no interaction in the vertical due to vertical advection of potential vorticity. The potential vorticity is just being advected horizontally. The interaction comes through the induction step or the inversion step, that given potential vorticity field, say in the lower troposphere, you can modify the potential vorticity just in the lower troposphere and modify the flow field in the upper troposphere, because this is a three-dimensional inversion. Do you have a question? Okay. So that's where the coupling comes from, in the inversion step. And so there's a little hint here when you think isentropically or isopictically that And you can make this idea precise. Here I haven't worked in isopycnal coordinates explicitly. But there's no mixing of layers. There's really no mixing, like just the opposite of like Kelvin-Helmholtz instability, where you have some layers and something happens at the interface between the layers, more or less, and you mix fluid between the two layers of your stratified atmosphere. Nothing like that is going on in QG theory. The layers are remaining intact. And the only things are only being mixed within these layers. But the layers are interacting with each other. So you have to develop a picture for how this interaction's occurring. But at least in this formal sense, the interaction's occurring at the point where you invert the potential vorticity in three dimensions to get the stream function. Okay, so let's go through some of the things we talked about here. Again, I won't be able to stop to derive these things, but how about energetics? Okay, we got the energetics rather quickly from the two-dimensional flow by multiplying by the stream function, integrating over the domain. Turns out you can do exactly the same thing here. And you get the energy conservation. What's the expression for the quantity that's conserved? It's the kinetic energy plus what we call the available potential energy. Z squared dz integrated over three dimensions. This is, I say, if you have these buoyancy perturbations compared to your reference atmosphere, which you can think of as being have a horizontal, you know, isopycnal surfaces, when you have these buoyancy perturbations, you have potential energy in the system that's available to you when you relax to a uniform stratified flow or state. So kinetic energy and available potential energy. When the conversion, say from the mean, when you have eddies and mean flows, you have conversion of mean kinetic energy to eddy kinetic energy and mean potential available potential energy, et cetera. When the kinetic energy is sort of dominating the energetics, that's more or less just like two-dimensional flow. When it's the available potential energy that's dominating things, that's fundamentally baroclinic eddy dynamics or whatever. Yep. This is easy to prove too. Just
quick question about the second term. So why do you? I'm a bit confused. Why do you make the distinction between available potential energy and potential energy?
I don't have to call it anything. Do you want to call it something else? This is what QG theory conserves. Are you, you're just questioning the terminology?
No, I'm just asking what this second term, that's potential energy, is,
yeah,
isn't it?
Right, but if, remember the
so I'm just, I guess I'm just
yeah,
asking
sure.
the fact that you call it available
yeah,
potential energy suggests it's different than potential energy, is it or not?
It's, let me this buoyancy is a departure from a reference atmosphere that has a static stability with no horizontal variation in buoyancy or density. So there's a reference atmosphere there. That reference atmosphere has potential energy, obviously. Yeah. And for ideal gas has internal energy too. But say it's not available to the system in the sense that we're assuming that we just have small departures from that reference state. You can generalize the concept of available potential energy.
So you're saying it's available in the sense that it won't change the background?
Another, more generally, in the way Lorentz, of course, Ed Lorentz introduced this concept, take a state of the atmosphere and assume everything's adiabatic, and you just rearrange the density of all the parcels in such a way as to minimize the potential energy of the atmosphere. How would you do that? You'd make a horizontal uniform density, horizontal uniform stratified. That would be have the minimum amount of potential energy. The dynamics cannot tap any more potential energy than that, because that's the minimum you can get to by adiabatic redistribution. So there's a big reservoir of potential energy that's irrelevant. That's why Ed Lorentz and others talked about available potential energy.
Good question about the static stability. So it seems like the QG only would consider one single profile of that. Do you think it's relevant to think the static stability within the storm track, or like the entire hemisphere average is a more appropriate static stability to think of? Because those two are very different, and in the real atmosphere we have a three-dimensional profile of that thing.
That's one of the limitations of QG theory. Why are we doing QG theory in the first place? Nowadays especially, you don't use QG theory if you're trying to model, quantitatively model a middle-latitude storm track. Why? You use a full, much more realistic set of equations. We're doing it to develop insight into the dynamics. And it's really, this simplification, one scalar quantity that we're inventing is a huge simplification formally compared to, say, the primitive equation. I'm not here worrying about that kind of quantitative question. I'm not dismissing it. It says, well, you're going to have trouble if you try to use this theory quantitatively. Okay, so what else did we say here besides the energetics? I had this mean flow equation. And we also had this interesting result. The vorticity flux is the momentum flux convergence. Instead of vorticity flux, we want to talk about potential vorticity flux, because let's agree to forget about the boundary for a minute. Let's suppose we're in the middle of empty space, the boundary's far away. Or you can assume at the boundary the buoyancy is uniform. So it sort of drops out of the problem. There's no dynamics there anymore. In either case, the problem just reduces to this interior evolution of potential vorticity. And that's the state of the system is defined by this quantity. So what do we care about if you have eddies doing things? What do we want to know about the eddies? We want to know the flux of potential vorticity by the eddies. In fact, that's all we want to know. If we're just interested in how the eddies modify the mean flow, I'm exaggerating a little bit. Because you could have a forcing in your system that maybe depends on eddy kinetic energy or something, who knows what. It could be nonlinear. But at least as far as the dynamics is telling us, what we want to focus on are the fluxes of potential vorticity. Yeah. And that's an interesting thing, because what if I first of all, before getting into the analog of this, let's talk about the analog of this equation. Because if I write down an equation for the zonal mean flow in QG theory, I can erase this now. What does it look like? And I also have an equation for the zonal mean buoyancy. Again, you have to derive this. You have momentum flux convergence, just as before, where this is the u and v from the geostrophic, from the stream function, just as in 2D flow. But the only extra thing we have in QG theory is now we have a mean meridional circulation. Because in the atmosphere, we have mean meridional circulation, so we have the Hadley cell, we have the Farrell cell. And this is F naught. This is ageostrophic. So that's the QG momentum equation, which I haven't derived here, from which you can get the QG vorticity equation. Zonally average. And what's the zonally average buoyancy equation? Well, you have a buoyancy flux. These are the geostrophic, V prime and B prime. And then you have the zonal mean adiabatic vertical motion. So these two equations are now the analog of this equation. So you say, here's the conundrum. You have, before we just were interested in momentum fluxes. Now we're interested in momentum fluxes and heat fluxes. Which makes sense, because we're talking about temperature as well. The whole point here is to talk about temperature, things like the polar equator temperature gradient. Okay, that makes sense, but there's a problem here, because saying, is this really what I want to know about the eddies? Momentum fluxes and heat fluxes? Because that's, think about, so this thing is a function of y and z. It's only average, so there's no x. It's a function of y and z. This thing's a function of y and z. So there are two functions of y and z. It looks like, according to these, I need to know. If I want to parameterize the effect of eddies on the mean flow, or develop a theory for effect of eddies on the mean flow. But that can't be right, because I know that from the potential vorticity equation, there's only one quantity I need to know, one function of y and z, and that's the eddy potential vorticity flux. Let's forget about the boundary condition, because if I zonally average this equation, all I get is the potential vorticity flux. They say, then I know the zonal mean potential vorticity. That's all I need to know, because I can invert it to get the temperature in the flow field. The potential vorticity is the entire state of the system. So momentum fluxes and heat fluxes is too much information. It's twice as much information as I need, which is kind of striking. So it's misleading. This wave, right, is sometimes we call this the traditional form of the equations of motion. It's misleading in telling you, it's not pointing you to the quantity that you really want to know. It makes it look like you need to know more than you really need to know. So what is the relationship between momentum flux, heat flux, and potential vorticity flux? So we have a famous relationship that's analogous to this one, which you can derive. The potential vorticity flux is related to the heat flux. Heat flux, right? So just as for the moment vorticity flux in 2D theory, the potential vorticity flux is the divergence of something. Now it's a divergence in the yz plane of all. What is this? We can think of this as a horizontal and a vertical component of something, given different names. Some people call that the Elias and Palm flux. Elias and Palm didn't call it that, but Michael McIntyre started referring to it as the Elias and Palm flux, which I think is appropriate from the point of view of what they did in their paper. But I like to call it the flux of pseudomomentum. That's what it is. So just as here, we have this pseudo-momentum conservation equation, and there's a divergence of a flux that's giving you it's the flux of pseudo-momentum. And in the 2D problem, the flux of pseudo-momentum is just minus the momentum flux. But in this problem, we have both horizontal and vertical fluxes of pseudo-momentum. I haven't really talked in I don't know if Ted Shepard talked much about pseudo-momentum, did he? He probably talked it from some esoteric Hamiltonian perspective, I'm guessing. Sometimes it's just nice to work out some very simple linear examples. And then, at least for me, I can't understand a word of that stuff unless I have, and then I can build up a more general one if I have some simple examples.
Can you give us your intuition about pseudo-momentum?
Yeah, well, it's a conservation law that exists when you have translational invariance of. Let me just talk about linear theory, I don't know if that'll satisfy you. In linear theory, it's a conservation law that exists when the basic state is translationally invariant. Any problem you have that has a translationally invariant basic state will have a pseudo-momentum.
Physically.
Well, you mean in this context, for example. Can I come back to that in a few seconds? That'll maybe be the last thing for this opening lecture. We'll get to turbulence eventually. this is a strange relationship in a way. But we can use it, for example, to now we know, let's forget about the lower boundary. Suppose it doesn't exist. Then if in particular the potential vorticity flux integrates to zero. You can say, oh, maybe this turbulence, the same words I used in the 2D case. Maybe I got some complicated turbulent flow that's mixing up the potential vorticity. Maybe it's going to mix the potential vorticity down gradient, or who knows what. You better be careful, because it has to integrate to zero. And, of course, that gives you this called the Charney-Stern criterion for Baryk-Linnegan instability. I don't even have to rederive the result. It's the same result. It's pseudo-momentum conservation. I write, but now the pseudo-momentum is the, should I write it down? If there's no boundary, it's the potential entropy squared if I, this is just linear theory again. Sorry, so again, I'm linearizing about some zonal flow. Now that zonal flow is a balanced flow that has both y and z dependence. So it's, I have a temperature field and a wind field that are in balance. I'm looking at the instability of that field. And it has a potential vorticity gradient. Sorry about my background, my what is the potential vorticity gradient if I have some flow? It's function y and z. Again, it has this horizontal curvature term. But it also has this vertical curvature term. If the static stability is independent of z, I can rescale my vertical coordinate by using what's called the Prandtl ratio, because Prandtl talked about it. F over n, n over f times z. The buoyancy, these are both frequencies. There's the buoyancy frequency and a Coriolis frequency times z. I can call that a rescaled coordinate zeta. That gets rid of all these constants there. I can only do that directly anyway if n squared is a constant. So then I have a horizontal curvature and a vertical curvature. They come in exactly the same way. That's pretty interesting. If I only have vertical curvature, the problems are pretty, that's pretty similar kind of thing. Anyway, if this potential vorticity gradient is of one sign, dominated by beta, then the flow is stable. Same argument. I have a norm that's positive definite. That's stability in the most powerful sense that you can imagine, at least for linear. If something is initially infinitesimal, it has to be infinitesimal for all time. That doesn't mean you can't wobble around a little bit. So that's the Czerny-Stern criterion for baroclinic instability. Potential vorticity gradient has to change psi, otherwise you're not a candidate for instability. That's in the absence of the boundary condition. The boundary condition is all important here, because typically in the atmosphere, at least classically, beta dominates in the interior. Neither of these curvature terms is enough to change the sign of potential vorticity gradient, typically, certainly for the large-scale atmospheric flow. So where's the instability coming from? Well, it's coming from the boundary condition. And when you rederive this result in the presence of a boundary, you get another term. So this is an integral over dy dz. But then you get another term, which is an integral of the buoyancy flux divided by the buoyancy gradient at the ground. Probably not getting the sign right here. But the sign is such that if you're dominated by beta in the interior, and if you have temperature decreasing poleward, which is not an uncommon situation, in fact, that's what we have, then you're a candidate for instability, according to the Czerny-Stern criterion, in the presence of the boundary. The pseudomomentum in general has this boundary term as well. One way of thinking about that I often find very useful is that suppose we have some shear flow as in the atmosphere. So we have some shear and we have some shear at the boundary, which means we have a temperature gradient at the boundary, a horizontal temperature gradient at the boundary. And so this is the classic Czerny basic state. He looked at the stability of. And it's unstable because of the shear at the boundary, according to the Czerny-Stern stability criterion. One way of thinking about it, this isn't really physically different than if I, in a very thin layer, I get rid of the temperature gradient and replace it by a lot of vertical curvature. I've just changed the flow in an infinitesimal layer. How can that change anything? In fact, it doesn't. Mathematically, this is a fine thing to do, both linearly and non-linearly in QG theory. I can replace the boundary condition by It's just saying I have a delta function contribution to the interior potential vorticity. But you can think of this physically too. So there's a, you could say this destabilization of the atmosphere by the surface temperature gradient is as if it's introducing very concentrated vertical curvature into the momentum equation, and that's enough to destabilize by this term, to destabilize the atmosphere. It's kind of an abstract way of explaining why the atmosphere is filled up with eddies in middle latitudes, but that's one way of thinking. So boundary condition complicates these things a little bit, but it's not fundamentally more complicated. It's just an extra term that's vitally important in reality. This starts looking like this. This is the last thing I'll say before we break. Oops. I still have one thing to say before we break.
Just one question concerning this destabilization. Yeah. Then the scales of the instability that are consistent with the initial assumption of the scale separation between vertical and horizontal.
I don't think I said anything about scale separation.
No, no.
I think
for the quasi, yes, for the quasi-holotropic dynamics to hold.
I don't think I've said anything about scale separation. I just talked about, there are really three small parameters in QG theory. There's the Rossby number. And you can ask, okay, I start out with initially small Rossby number. How do I know as time evolves the Rossby number is going to stay small? It's not. If you're trying to prove QG theory in some fundamentally, say, some fundamentally self-consistent description of a more complete set of equations that sort of mirrors the evolution over time of the more complete system, you'll never do it. It's not that kind of approximation. You don't have control of the Rossby number in general. Just a little bit of a tangent, but I don't pay much attention to people who try to improve on the sort of perturbation theory or textbook approach to how you would derive QG theory. I just think of it as heuristic. There's nothing rigorous going on. And the approximation isn't interesting to me because it's formally rigorous in some sense. It's interesting to me because of the insights that many people over the years, I have this evolutionary theory for approximations. The ones that survive are the ones that are useful, not the ones that are rigorous. The rigor of derivation has nothing to do with whether it's useful or not. I think they're orthogonal. I'm a little on the left field in that respect, maybe. I was going to make another point here. Okay, so this looks like the point jet problem we had earlier, right? So what is, if this, we have this like Czerny basic state, which is like, and this is actually, it'll simplify from what Czerny actually did. Czerny actually used an ideal gas. Let's not worry about. We have an ideal gas, there's another scale, that's the scale height of the atmosphere that comes in. We're sort of ignoring that. It's not a big deal. So the atmosphere has this temperature gradient, it's not satisfying the Czerny Stirn criterion in the presence of a boundary, it's unstable. What are the eddies going to try to do? Let's make exactly the same argument we made before. The eddies are going to try to remove this infinite curvature. And how are they going to do that? Same way as before. Let's not worry about the details. They're going to spread this over a certain depth. Maybe. If they're smart. If they have some idea that, what is the minimum I can do to stabilize the flow? Maybe they'll do that. What is that scale? That depth scale? You can show it's F squared du dz over beta n squared. So how is this related to the barotropic result? I erased it. We had the scale lambda over beta. Lambda is just, you can think of du dz here. But instead of talking, but we have this scaling of the vertical coordinate from z to zeta, scaled by the Prandtl ratio. And there are two heights here. So if we rescale z by the Prandtl ratio whenever it occurs, and rescale this height by the Prandtl ratio, I think it's the same argument. It's just this n squared over f squared is hanging there. So if we measure in terms of a in this rescaled vertical coordinate, this depth, and we write this vertical shear in this rescaled vertical coordinate, you'll get the same barotropic result. Yeah, it seems like kind of an esoteric thing, but is it? What is the troposphere? That's a pretty. it's the scale over which baroclinic instabilities mixing things up. If you think of the troposphere as maintained by baroclinic instability, but I mean the radiation's trying to destabilize the atmosphere. The dynamics, in some complicated way, is fighting that off and stabilizing it. There's moist convection, which you've heard about already, and that gets mixed into this question. And this, at least mid-latitude troposphere and static stability is a tough problem because it's not clear moist convection isn't playing a significant role. Even though it's not as profoundly dominant as in the tropics, it's still there. It's still maybe playing, I mean, we have thunderstorms. But in models and whether it's, you know, the exactly the right limit, there's a scale in a situation like this over which the baroclinic eddies are trying to do their work. And so is this what is controlling the depth of the troposphere, the height of the tropopause in mid-latitudes? So do you think it's, so you say it's analogous to the point jet problem. If I do the nonlinear dynamics of the point jet problem, do I understand this baroclinic problem? I don't know, that's an interesting question. From some kind of, if somehow your theory is working with conservation laws that have the same structure in two dimensions and QG theory, maybe, but if you think about it for a moment, these problems are profoundly different because you can think of, I mean, the only fluxes we have in this problem are horizontal, and particularly we have horizontal PV fluxes. Or if you want to, you can think about horizontal momentum fluxes, heat fluxes. And so the dynamics is horizontal in this problem, and yet we're changing the vertical structure of the flow. But in the 2D problem, the mixing, the dynamics is in the same plane as the, you know, it's mixing, it's inhomogeneous in a very different sense. But this problem is you're redistributing momentum in the vertical through horizontal fluxes. And that'll be the key for the next half of this morning because of that we can construct horizontally homogeneous turbulence frameworks for studying this problem. I won't actually do this problem, but it's one could do. Is Peter Haynes here? Peter had a, no, I guess he's out hiking or something. he had a paper a few years ago on this. And I tried to look at it, but I won't go back to this specifically because we're going to go to the two-layer model. The two-layer model, you're not talking about what's controlling the depth of the troposphere. You're just giving yourself that. But, you know, when I look at the what's actually happening in this QG dynamics and 2D dynamics, they're totally unrelated. But in the barotropic problem, you're mixing in this plane. In the baroclinic problem, you're mixing in this plane. I don't know if that made sense, but if you wave your hands enough, you can. So we'll come, now we'll try to move quickly in the second half to talk about, at least pose a horizontally homogeneous turbulence problem.
Questions? I have just one question on the last, the height of the tropopause. Because mm-hmm. In the first lecture, you told us that the tent is hold the.
That was tropical.
So
that was the tropical tropopause.
But there could be an influence done to the.
Yeah. When you look at the tropopause, it's kind of interesting. There's a tropopause jump. The tropical tropopause is much higher than the exotropic. It's about the subtropical jet. you have this pretty sharp transition from, like, the best, you know, people talk about the expansion of the tropics, quote unquote. I think the best way of defining that is the area covered by tropical tropopause, which does maybe expanding a little bit. There's a pretty sharp distinction between tropical tropopause and extratropical tropopause. Whether the dynamics is fundamental, I think there's a potential for the dynamics to be fundamentally different, whether it is or not. So my tent is for the tropics.
Okay.
But, nope. False. Yeah, I'll take a break.